Now, with a view to the blessing of God and his guidance and help, let's turn to the passage which we read in Matthew and chapter 11, page 1124. And we'll read again the last four verses of the chapter. So at verse 27, "All things have been delivered to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, nor does anyone know the Father except the Son and the one to whom the Son wills to reveal him. Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." So especially that invitation to us all, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Now, last Lord's Day evening, we saw the earlier part of this chapter, verses 21, 22, and 23, where Christ pronounces a woe upon the cities which had heard and seen the most. They were his own home cities in Galilee of Capernaum, Chorazin, and Bethsaida. He preached most there, and he performed most miracles there. And because of their failure to recognize him as the Son of God, and their failure to respond to his truth and to his miracles, he pronounced that severe woe upon them. He told them that if even the city of Sodom had seen and heard what they had seen and heard, there would have been at least an outward repentance that would have stopped the wrath of God falling upon them. And Christ says, the fact is that it'll be better off to be a resident of Sodom on the day of judgment than to have been a resident of Capernaum in the day of my preaching and in the day of my ministry. A very solemn message to ourselves, a reminder that our responsibility is always according to our privilege. If God gives much, then much is required. Now, it's quite remarkable, really, that such a solemn woe doesn't end the passage. What's really staggering is that the tone of the passage suddenly seems to change. Christ acknowledges in prayer that it is the Father's will to give and to withhold. He is right in pronouncing a woe. He is right in pronouncing his blessings. And the marvelous thing is that Christ then turns after pronouncing such a solemn woe, and he turns to anyone who has ears to hear. And he utters this glorious invitation in verse 27. Before the time of woe comes and before the judgment comes, come to me, all you who labor and are heavily burdened, and I will give you rest. So this is a call really to recognize who he actually is as the Son of God and to come to him. Whatever that means, it means obviously the same as to believe in him or to rest on him. We'll see that as we go on. So it's a call to recognize him as the Son of God and to come to him, and in coming to him, to find that rest that your soul so desperately needs. So that instead of the hell that awaits the residents of Capernaum, they would instead embrace him and find heaven, a heavenly rest in the Lord Jesus Christ. So having looked at the woe, let's now look at the invitation to blessing. And we'll look at it very simply under three headings. First of all, let's look at those who are invited here. And that is essentially all of us. We are described as a people who are laboring and are heavily burden. That's you and that's me. So the invitation is to you and to me as a laboring heavily burdened people. Second, what are we invited actually to do? What is it that he's inviting us to do? Well, he's inviting us to come to himself. Come to me. And you'll notice that that carries two other ideas along with it. To come to Christ involves taking his yoke, verse 29, take my yoke upon you. And it also involves learning from him. The same verse, take my yoke upon you and learn from me. So we're all invited to come to Christ, to take his yoke, and to learn. And if we do so, the marvelous promise is, at the end of verse 28, I will give you rest. Or again at the end of verse 29, you will find rest for your souls. As we'll see, rest is a marvelous word. And the longer we live, I guess, the more we realize how much we need that rest of God and how restless we are in our souls. So it's a great invitation to come to a great Lord, a great Master, a great Teacher, and to find a great reward, rest in your soul. Now let's look at these things just as we have them there before us. First of all of us invited. But notice how we're described. We are laboring and heavily burdened. And the image that's carried through in these verses is that of an ox ploughing under a yoke. Now, I'm conscious that these are images that perhaps we're not all that familiar with anymore. So it may be worth just stopping for a little while to make sure we have the figure or the picture in our head. When the soil was being turned long ago, and we were thinking of that this morning, it was done with a plough. It wasn't done with tractors or whatever. It was done with a plough. And that's just a heavy wooden instrument. And it was used to turn the soil. Now, instead of people pulling it, which would normally happen, what would happen is that you would train an ox to do it, because, of course, an ox is strong. So the oxen would pull the plough behind them. Now, the yoke was the thing that attached the oxen to the plough itself. And it just lay, its weight lay heavily on the ox's neck, which, as you know, is very, very strong, and on its upper back. That's where the yoke lay. And when that yoke lies on the oxen, of course, the oxen goes and it pulls the plough, hopefully ploughing a straight furrow. Now, that is the image Christ uses here to speak of ourselves, making our journey from the womb to the tomb, our journey from birth to death through this world. It's a short journey. We realize as time goes on that it's a very short journey, but it's a difficult journey. It's a laborious journey. We all have our own work to do, as God in his providence ordains it. And we all have our different situations of life in which we do it. So we all have our talents, our opportunities, our privileges, and our duties. And we all have different relationships with different people. Some of us have wives, husbands, and family, friends, relatives, colleagues, acquaintances, and so on. The whole thing is just the collective environment in which you live and you exist in this world. And in that situation, irrespective of who you are and how many friends or colleagues or acquaintances you have or how many talents or opportunities and privileges you have, irrespective of all that, you labor and you are heavily burdened. Sometimes you know it. Sometimes you can forget it. Most of the time, you know it. And our work, it doesn't matter how much we like a particular calling and how lawful it is, because of the way things are, we feel it to be a labor. This word labor in the Greek language means to toil to the point of weariness. That somehow seems to sum us up. The longer you live, the more you feel it. Now, the fact is that it ought not to be so. It's not that long since we were looking at these things here. Man was made to work, not to toil. When God created man, he put him in the Garden of Eden. And there was a furrow to plough. He was to dress the garden, and he was to keep it. He was to subdue the earth. That was the mandate that man and woman were given, created in God's image and in his likeness. So a pregnant earth was to be cultivated to the point where the whole of the world appeared like Eden itself, singing, as it were, the praise of God in its beauty and in its glory. That was Adam's task, it was Eve's, and it was the task of the children, as God would give children to them. And of course, God put a yoke on their backs in the Garden of Eden. And the yoke was simply, do this and live. Walk with me. Stay in my love. Stay in relationship with me. Have no other gods before me. Use no graven image in my worship. Never carry my name in vain. Always reverence my Sabbath. Teach your children to honor their parents. Respect the purity of the sexual relationship. Respect life. Respect property. Never covet. Stay like this, and you will live. You will live forever. In fact, I will raise you further. The probation will be over, and your state of blessedness will be absolutely complete. So that's the yoke that God places on Adam and Eve. And we can say that God's yoke was easy and God's burden is light. Now, that's not maybe the way you feel the law of God. The reason for that is obvious. It's because you're a sinner. Things have changed, and we'll come to that in a moment. But that's how it felt for Adam. That's how it felt for Eve. It was a pleasure. It was pleasantness to do the will of God. Until, as we saw not that long ago, the devil altered their perception of reality. So there was no sweat of the brow. There was no agony. There was no toil. There was no possibility of collapsing into a Sabbath because of utter weariness throughout the week. No. Everything was the way it was meant to be. But it changed. And so it's changed for you and for me. Why? Well, because of sin. When sin comes into the world, it doesn't sit there like a cloud. It comes into you. It comes into your life. It comes into your calling. It comes into your relationships. It comes into your experience. Because it's in your experience, it's in your relationship, it's in your callings. And it turns everything in life that was supposed to be pleasant and light and easy, it makes it all hard and difficult. Work becomes a labor, and it becomes a toil. How? Well, simply because sin burdens you. It puts burdens on your back. Sometimes you don't recognize them. Life's like that. Sometimes things are wrong and you don't know why they're wrong. You can't put your finger on exactly what's wrong or how it's wrong. And you're quite possibly here tonight miserable, and you're trying to work out why you're miserable. You think it's your marriage that's making you miserable. You may think it's your parents that are making you miserable, or your children, or your work. But in fact, you're miserable because you're miserable yourself. You're out of step with God. You're not right with God. You haven't dealt with sin. In other words, sin is making you miserable. If you could deal with your sin, you could deal with everything else. And the things that appear to you then so difficult and such a burden, well, wouldn't be a burden in the same way at all. The problem is on the inside. The problem is with yourself. And you just don't see it and you don't realize it. But let me tell you, friend, if you're not a Christian tonight, if you're not a believer in God, there are burdens on your back that you really need to recognize. The first of these burdens is the burden of alienation from God. Alienation from God. How do you feel that burden? You feel it in a sense of homelessness, a sense of void, a sense of vanity, of lack of fulfillment, having no fixed abode, floating in a world that doesn't really know you or care for you. You're not sure why you're in it, what your place is in it, whether there's any meaning to it or not. You just don't know. You have no clue as to why you're here or what you even are. You just don't know. It's the crushing refrain of the book of Ecclesiastes in the Old Testament. Have you ever read it? The refrain is vanity of vanities. All is vanity, or meaninglessness, meaninglessness. All is meaningless. I well remember when that book spoke so powerfully to myself at 18 years of age, because God saw to it that it spoke to me. And may its message speak to you too. King Solomon records in that book how he strove to find fulfillment and purpose in life. Like most of us, he tried to find it in work. How many of you do that? He tried to find it in pleasure, in drinking wine. How many of you do that? He tried to find it in culture and in art. How many of you do that? You think by immersing yourself in these things, you will somehow find this mysterious meaning of life, this purpose for your existence, and you will have this sense of fulfillment that you long for so much. But Solomon said, I didn't get it. I didn't get it in wine. I didn't get it in culture or in art. I didn't get it in work. I mean, thank God at the close of the book, he found it in God, where he says in the immortal words that the sum and substance of life is to fear God and to keep his commandments. In the immortal words of the Shorter Catechism, our chief end, to glorify God and to enjoy him forever. But apart from that God, there is this sense of alienation from him, which reveals itself in that vanity, in that emptiness. And the joy and the peace that you look for, I don't say they never come. Sometimes they do. But they're just strangers, fleeting strangers. In they come and out they go. And you're back to the meaningless emptiness that you had to begin with. But the reason for that is that you are alienated from God. That's the reason for that. If you weren't, you would have a sense of purpose. You would have a sense of belonging. You would have a sense of being at home. You would have a sense of destination, knowing where you have come from, knowing where you are going, knowing that God is preparing you for that place. You would have all that, a sense of friendship and fellowship and communion, but you have none of that. And so you float, unconnected, disconnected, meaningless, perhaps near despair. And of course, as well as that burden, there's the burden of alienation from one another too. The fact is that sin didn't just spoil our relationship with God, it spoils our relationship with each other. Where we should love and care and value and esteem, in comes what? Well, the list's as long as your arm. Envy, anger, hatred, malice, bitterness, resentment, jealousy, and I just noted these down as specimens. I felt I could have gone on all day, and so I can, and you know it. And it's in yourself. It's in your relationship with your work colleagues. Sadly, it's in your relationship with your brothers and sisters. It's in your relationship with your wife and with your husband. It's in the church. It's out of the church. It's in the world. It's everywhere, because sin is there. It cuts you off. And it's a strange thing, you know, but this horizontal, I mean, there's the vertical disorder. There's the vertical alienation, ourselves and God. The horizontal one is so real too. And as you go on in life, you feel it. Have you ever wondered why it is that as you go on in life, you feel outside of Christ, you feel more and more alone, you feel more and more isolated? It seems that every relationship is affected, and it's just you're more and more alone. Well, that's what sin does, friend. It divides you. It separates you. It isolates you out. I've said it so often, even from this pulpit itself, that the glimpses we have of hell are intensely lonely places where no one is conscious of fellowship, warmth, and kindness. You are just utterly alone because sin isolates you. So there's a burden of alienation from God. You don't know who you are, where you're from, or why, and a burden of alienation from one another. But there's also the burden of guilt. And I don't know how much you feel that, because obviously you try and get rid of that burden. Instead of dealing with it, you try and get rid of it in your own way. But I'd be surprised if most of you don't feel, to some extent, a burden of guilt on your back. In other words, God is not just a stranger, but God is your enemy. And if that's how you feel, well, you're right to feel it. Or at least God is at enmity with you. You are not right with him. And the enmity is on your side. And because it is there, God is not right with you. You have a sense of guilt because God's perfect law is stamped on your heart. It's written in your conscience. You know the truth. You know the truth is the truth. You may wish to disbelieve it. You can argue yourself all day long into atheism, and to some extent you may be very, very successful. You can sear your conscience like a hot iron. When a hot iron cauterizes the skin becomes desensitized, unable to feel. And it is possible that your conscience has arrived there, although I hope to God it has not. But ordinarily, that writing is there, and you know it. You feel it, you believe it, that God is true, and his law is holy and just and good. And it'll one day bring you to its judgment seat and judge you. Yes, you do. It's very, very difficult to shake that off, is it not? It really seems to be the case that there's no argument in the world powerful enough to persuade you that your life is meaningless. You know yourself to be more than mud and matter. You know yourself to be more than that. You know that what goes on in here or in here, however you choose to think of it, what goes on in there is so much more than mere matter and physics and chemistry. And when this word explains it to you, when it describes to you how and why you're so different, it chimes in here. Part of you says, no, I don't want that to be true. But you know, there's a part in you that testifies to the truth of it. Yes, what you're stamped with is the image and the likeness of God. And you know that you have broken God's law and that you're guilty. You're here tonight as a murderer because you hate. You're here tonight as an adulterer because you've had thoughts of adultery in your heart. You're here tonight as a Sabbath breaker, as someone who has stolen and who has coveted, as someone who has disrespected parents. You're here tonight as someone who has put even yourself before God. You are here tonight as a hell-deserving sinner. Right? Yes. And you know it to be true. You know it to be true that you sit there in the pew guilty before God. That's what you are. And there is no way on earth that you can eradicate that guilt and wipe the slate clean and somehow appear innocent before the judgment seat of God. Can't be done. Can't be done. And that's why you have something called the fear of death at the same time. Hebrews 2 tells us that you and myself with you, by nature, have the fear of death. Now, you may wish to describe that as a natural evolutionary instinct, something to do with self-preservation and the propagation of the species. So a natural evolutionary instinct. No, it's an acquired spiritual instinct. It's a sense of doom that you have because you have broken the law of God. Fear of death. It came in with sin. It came in with its defilement and its ruin and its misery. When God is angry with you, there is a consequence to that. Death is not the end, it's the beginning. And as I've said before, it's not the fear of the unknown, it's the fear of the suspected or the known. You know fine well in your own soul that death is not the end. Accountability. Accountability. Judgment. Your choices have consequences. God will deal with a lot of them. The lot of them. Yes, you sometimes wonder in this world what it all means. The sheer injustice, whatever that is. I don't know what injustice is in a godless world, but assuming for the moment, as we should, that God is real, the injustice of it all, the iniquity of it all, the inequality of it all, the staggering evil that is perpetrated. And do you suppose, honestly, that it doesn't matter? Do you suppose that the death of the saintliest man in Scotland is just the same as the death of Pol Pot or of Adolf Hitler? Do you think it's just the same? Oh, they lived and they died. No, it's not. I mean, we all say, as Paul says, we must all carry our own load. He's talking there about appearing before the judgment seat of Christ, and he says, we must all carry our own load there. You will, your kali, your thoughts, your judgments, your decisions, your choices. You'll carry it all to the judgment seat of God, and he's going to deal with it. Deal with it. It must be dealt with. And you know that deep down in your heart to be true. And that's the yoke that's on us. We are burdened, alienated from a God who is in fact not just a stranger but an enemy, and a sense of guilt lying on our neck. And it makes our chore through this life all the harder. Meaninglessness, emptiness, or guilt, alienation, these things pervade your life and make your labor a toil. And of course you try to remove that yoke. You blot God out. You blot his voice out. You blot out thoughts of God. You deny that he exists. So good, relief, no sin, no guilt, no judgment. Or perhaps you decide, instead of God creating you in his image and likeness, that you will recreate him in your own image and likeness. So you'll change the nature of God. So that instead of one who is infinite, eternal, and unchangeable, in being wisdom, holiness, justice, goodness, and truth, he becomes a cuddly toy that you can take with you to bed at night. Someone who's there who has the sole purpose of making you feel good and affirming all your choices in life.
And the staggering thing is that you can go to churches throughout the length and breadth of the land who will present a cuddly toy type of God for you like that. He's there for you to squeeze and to make you feel good. He's there to affirm all your choices and say, I understand, and it's all okay. So you've recreated God in your own image and likeness. Perhaps you can even try a more honorable route and simply try to please him, to keep his commandments as hard as you can. Keep them. Maybe even take one. Maybe something like the Sabbath day, and keep it as rigidly and as rigorously as you can, thinking that by exhausting yourself in keeping one commandment, maybe, just maybe, you can please God enough. You don't understand God. You don't understand God. You don't understand the way of salvation. You don't understand how sick you are. You don't understand how sinful you are. If you think that the mere exertion of effort on your part in keeping a commandment can resolve the situation, we haven't started yet. That just cannot be done. None of it will really do. All these things are like the injections that the athletes and footballers use to get on with the game. They're really injured, but they just get an injection, at least this is what used to happen on a large scale, and they go out and they play, and they play through the game, you see. And what's happened? They're worse than they ever were before. It masked the problem. Didn't solve it. In fact, they were worse. But it masked it, and you're masking the problem in all these ways. You've got lots of ways of masking the problem. What's the cure? Is there a cure? Well, yes. Yes, here it is. Come to me, you who labor in life with all your burdens. Come to me, and I will give you rest. It's not the main point. Well, it is in a way the main point here, but in a way it's easy to miss it. How amazing it is to hear someone saying, come to me, and I'll sort it out. You know, if he had even said, come to me and I'll tell you how to sort it out. But he actually says, come to me and I will personally sort it out. Isn't that staggering? There are so many explicit claims to divinity in the Bible. So many points at which Christ explicitly demonstrates that he is the Son of God. But there are so many points at which it's implicit too. I mean, who could speak like this really? Unless he was conscious himself of being God. The only one who can actually sort out your problem. I mean, you can take it as given that only God can sort out the problem between yourself and God. But this man claims that he can actually do it himself in his own strength, in his own wisdom, and in his power. And how true that is. Come to me. And that's the glory of Christianity. It's not a philosophical remedy at the end of the day. Christianity is very much a religion that revolves around a person. It's not just a system of truth. It is truth in a person. Truth is found in a person. Truth is found in God. God is at the heart of all things. God in Christ. Religion, true religion, revolves around the person. I am the way, the truth, and the life. Philip, we don't know where you're going. Show us the Father. Show us God. How can we get to God? I am the way, because I am the truth, and I am the life. I am these things. Isn't that marvelous? I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man can come to the Father but by me. Or to flip that round positively, through me you can come to the Father. Come to me. In what way? How? In what sense? Well, come to me as Savior first. Your fundamental problem, remember, is sin.
It's sin that's destroyed you already, it's sin that's destroying you still, and it's sin that will destroy you ultimately. And what you need to sort out your life is not a better wage, and it's not a bigger house. Neither, for that matter, is it a smaller house. Neither is it a different husband. Neither is it better behaved children. What you need is to sort out your sin, friend. Sort out your relationship with God. Come to me as Savior. Recognize first that I am who I say I am. Do you believe that? Do you believe that the rabbi from Nazareth, the carpenter, the prophet, was more than a prophet? Do you believe that? Do you believe he was the greatest of the prophets? Do you believe in the pre-existence of Christ? Do you believe in the divinity of this man? Do you believe that this man who walked with 2 feet on the earth was the Son of God? Do you believe that? Do you believe that he coexisted with the Father and with the Holy Spirit from all eternity? Do you believe that? Do you believe that these marvelous words that you have in red in the Bible in front of you, and for that matter the words in black too, there's a sense in which they shouldn't be discriminated, do you believe that they're from his mouth as the Son of God? Do you believe that? When he revealed himself like that, do you think the Jews were right to stone him? Do you think he was a madman? Well, what do you think of him? What do you think of Christ? Don't die with that question unresolved. Don't die with it not answered. I mean, you've been privileged enough to hear the gospel. You have been. You've heard of Christ. Well, who is he? Who exactly is he? Don't brush off the question. Don't brush it off. Don't let another night go by without answering it. Don't call him a prophet. Don't damn the man with faint praise. Either give him the glory that belongs to him, or else call him a madman. Because the old dilemma is true, he is one or t'other. He doesn't sound to me like a man who's mad. He doesn't behave like a man who's mad. Those were the accusations he's got, but that's not how he appears to me in the scripture. Are these the words of a madman? You know what the only explanation is? That he was exactly who he claimed to be. He's from the other side. He's from another world. He's from beyond. An alien in this world. God appearing on this earth. Why? On a mission. That's what you must believe. If you're going to come to him as a savior, you mustn't just believe he's the Son of God, but that he came on a mission to do what? To seek and to save that which was lost. How? By dealing with your sins. Especially forgiving them by his work on the cross. What do you think the cross was about? The man who spoke all these marvelous words that you have here actually did die on a cross. Can you explain that? Can you explain the way he faced it and took it? The way he actually embraced it. Why? 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 Because he came to do that. He came to carry his own burden. Yours. He came to take it on his own back and deal with it so that he would lift it off yours. And if you come to Christ and confess your sins to him and plead his forgiveness, not only will he do that, not only will he take the burden of guilt off your back, but he'll deal with everything else as a consequence of that too. Every other burden you've got, he'll deal with it because he's dealing with this one, dealing with sin, because that's the root of them all, you see. You get these finance companies and they'll say, are you drowning in debt? We'll get rid of the whole thing. We'll sort out the situation so that you're able to live on afterwards as though there was no real problem. Now, I don't know how these things work and I'm not here to comment on that. But it's rather like that, but in a much better way.
He deals with your debt. He deals with the problem of your sin. And because that's dealt with, he'll look after everything else. Every single burden you've got, you will cast them on the Lord and discover that he will sustain you. So come to me as a Savior and your sins will be forgiven. But also, come to me as your Lord. Verse 29, take my yoke upon you. Oh, well, now that sounds strange. Take my yoke. I thought he was taking a yoke off me. Well, yes, he is. But he's also putting a yoke on you. What is it? Obedience to himself as a master. And you say, well, that's the same yoke I lost. The yoke that was giving me a problem was God's commands and his law and obedience to him. And now he's telling me to be obedient to himself. Ah, yes, but notice what he says in verse 30. My yoke is easy and my burden is light. How come? Well, you see, when you come to Christ as a Savior, you'll discover that he gives you a new nature. Changes you. And the sign of that change is that you start viewing obedience to him in a completely different way. It's something you want to do. It's not something you feel you ought to do alone, but something you actually now want to do. Jesus himself said when he came into this world, he said of his Father, to his Father, to do thy will I take delight, O thou my God that art. Yea, that most holy law of thine I have within my heart. Now you can say just exactly the same thing. I now take delight in doing your will. Your law is in my heart, and I love it. I delight in it. The new nature you've got when you come to Christ, he gives you a desire for holiness, for purity, for prayer, for fellowship, for church. All these things that may be a drag to you and a pain. When you come to Christ as the real solver of your problems, he gives you a new nature that delights in all these things. And you'll take his yoke gladly. You will want to obey your Savior. He is also a gracious teacher. As well as saying in verse 29, take my yoke upon you, he also says, and learn from me. He'll teach us all the lessons we need to learn in the Christian life. We don't know it all when we begin. Sometimes you get a view of Christianity from some people that you're supposed to be the perfect article at the start, and only when you're perfect can you begin. That's not Christianity. It's about beginning and then growing, enrolling in the school, and eventually graduating. That's the way to think of it. You enroll really as a little child. When you come, like Naaman, who we thought of recently, you don't know much. You know you want to be rid of your burdens, and you know that Christ is the one who deals with the burdens, and that's what matters to you. And you come to him as a Savior and a Lord. But this Lord and Master starts to teach you. Not as a tyrant. No. In fact, we're told that he is meek or gentle and lowly in heart. You'll notice that. He says, learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart. Now, that may well mean that gentleness and humility are the things that he teaches you. After all, that is true. Blessed are the meek. Blessed are the meek. He does teach us to cease from pride, rebellion, self-assertion. He teaches us to become more and more childlike. Humble. And you know, a child, by and large, is a happy person. It's generally the case, is it not, that children are happier than adults? Children are at their happiest when they're directed. I know some of it doesn't feel like that, but children are at their happiest when they're directed. when they subject to the loving themselves to the loving authority of their parents, they find their happiness and fulfillment. Jesus says the same thing. Except you become as little children, you shall no way enter the kingdom. And whoever humbles himself and keeps humbling himself as this little child, the same shall be greatest in my kingdom. So to learn meekness, to learn to stop asserting yourselves and to seek our own glory, that is the way to happiness in the kingdom of heaven. So Christ does teach humility. But when he says here that I am gentle and lowly in heart, he is talking about his own quality as a teacher and the way in which he teaches us the Christian life generally. He teaches us as someone who is meek, humble, and gentle. You won't need to fear me as though there's a tyrant in the room. You know, when a child has a tyrant for a teacher, what happens is that that child gets paralyzed. That child is not able to actually learn. Some of you have seen that happening. Some of you have known it to happen. The difference it makes when a teacher comes in who loves the child and is concerned to teach the child the subject because he or she loves the subject themselves. What a difference it makes. And when you enroll in this school, you have a teacher who loves the things of God and who delights to teach you about the Father and is so considerate of your personality. It's not going to crush you or tear you apart, but lovingly and graciously build you up into the knowledge of God so that you can be like himself. One who is meek and lowly in heart, who was tempted in all points like as you are, and yet without sin. I wouldn't like to learn the faith from anyone above Christ himself. Would you? Is there anyone who knows it better? No. Is there anyone who loves the faith more? No. Is there anyone with a more passionate desire to teach you the faith? No. Anyone more patient when you stumble and fall in the faith? No. How meek he was when the disciples sinned. How eager Christ was to restore the penitent. How quick he was to forgive those who were sorry. 70 times 7, still not enough. Your teacher is meek and lowly in heart. You're afraid, are you, of becoming a Christian? I can understand that, friends. I know, we all know why you might be afraid of becoming a Christian, but don't be afraid of your teacher. There is a healthy fear of God. You'll respect your teacher, and if you don't, you're better not enrolling in the school. Respect the teacher by all means, but I want you to know that this is the best and most gracious and kindest teacher that you would ever imagine. That's what he's telling you here. Take my yoke. Learn from me because I am gentle. The gentleness of Christ is a lovely, lovely thing, and how thankful we are for it. I have mismanaged my time again. I'm kind of getting tired of saying that myself, so one day I hope it will be a bit different. But can I close by saying that if we accept this invitation, what God gives us is rest. The word appears twice. The end of verse 28, I will give you rest. At the end of verse 29, you will find rest for your souls. You will find a Sabbath, a real rest, a real peace, a real quiet. There's many ways of describing that. Heaven is the fulfillment of it. But I want you to notice that verse 27, to my mind, is the best description of rest because it's connected to verse 28. So verse 27 here is often disconnected as though it's got nothing to do with the invitation of verse 28. But it's got everything to do with it. You see, verse 28 says, come to me. Why? Well, you'll notice at the end of verse 27 that nobody knows the Father except the Son, and the one to whom the Son wills to reveal him. Come to me. Suddenly you see it. Yes, yes. You are telling me, you are inviting me and calling me to come to you so that you will show me the Father. Yes, that's just it. And in showing us the Father, he will give us rest. When Christ said to Philip that he was going to see the Father, Philip said, "Show us the Father and it's sufficient for us." And he said, "Do you not know who I am, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father." The better you know me, the more you know the Father. I have come to reveal God, to reveal who he is and exactly what he is like. And yes, he is your Father. And as you come to know me, you will know more and more of the electing, loving, saving God who is your Father in heaven. And that is rest, fellowship with God, knowing that your sins are forgiven. When you come to God like this, and I'm closing with this, that changes all of life. You plow on from that point onwards with Christ's yoke on your neck and on your shoulders, and that makes the way to the tomb a lot easier, because you know that the way you're now plowing is the way to heaven. The burden of alienation, it's gone. You have a Father and a family. The burden of guilt, gone. There is no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. Trouble, peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Fear of death, gone. O death, where is your sting? You've got all that. You've got it. And you've got it simply because you came to Christ and believed in him. Now, why will you not accept this invitation? Tell me, what have you got to lose? You've got all that to gain. Do you not want that? Do you not honestly want all that? You've got all that to gain. What have you got to lose? Accept these useless burdens that are destroying you now and destroying you forever. Come to a Savior, a Lord, and a teacher, and you will find rest. Amen. Let us pray. Our gracious and merciful God, give us the wisdom to know that all we really seek is found in Christ. All that is best, all that is good, all that is wholesome and real is found in him. Outside is death, meaninglessness, unreality, blackness, and despair. Oh, help us to choose this day whom we are to serve, God or Baal, life or death. In Christ's name, amen. Our last psalm is a psalm most of us know well, Psalm 23, on page 229, to the tune Crimond. The Lord is my shepherd. And of course, that's brought more fully before us in the New Testament, where Jesus Christ himself is our Lord and our shepherd. And in the psalm, he guides us through all life's trials, feeding us and sustaining us, welcoming us at his table, following us with goodness and mercy until at the close of the psalm and at the close of our pilgrimage, God willing, we will dwell in the house of God forevermore, knowing him as our Father.